My background, I grew up here in the Meadow Valley. My family moved here in 1974. My dad was, he graduated in Forestry from U of W and was a sky crane pilot and helped do the initial logging with sky crane helicopters, with the large helicopters in the 1960s, late 1960s. So I love trees myself. I grew up in them. And so when I was 18, I started with the Department of Natural Resources on a fire engine and got to know all the back roads in Okanagan County and beyond in the state, in eastern Washington, and absolutely loved that. And then I moved on to the Forest Service after that. And then at the time that these fires happened, I was a volunteer. So I was actually on engines at the time of the Carlton Complex. And I was partway at the lower Methow on engine there, and then moved down to the terrace just to help save the water system at that time. Also, I was on Sleepy Hollow and Wenatchee on an engine, and on engines in the 2015 fires. This is going to go out. Okay, I'm also a coach, so I can yell without it. So I've coached track and field for 20 years and a ski school director up at the Loop for 17 years, so I do know how to yell. So I'm going to go ahead and get started here. I'm sorry. Jesse Dowers is going to help me, assist me here. That was the introduction that I was supposed to say. Go ahead. Okay. I'm obviously with Okanagan County Long-Term Recovery, and I'm going to talk mostly about the Carlton Complex, but also about the fears and things that came with the 2015 fires. So, what happened here? First, I want to know how many people were here through those fires. Okay, so a small amount. How many are from Eastern Washington? Okay, and Western Washington. Okay, so I want to say that as scary as it was here, I know that a lot of folks were scared to death on the West Coast, on the other side of the mountains, because they had relatives or friends or people here or property here. Even though you didn't live here. And it was highly impacting across the entire county. From a personal perspective, having started fighting fire in 1984, going through this fire in 2014, it was the worst communication that we've ever had with radios. We couldn't talk to each other. Things were jammed up. As Julie Millier said, our cell phones went down. Verizon stayed up in 2014. AT&T went down. It flip-flopped in the 2015 fires. So luckily, it was an absolute miracle that we didn't lose anybody in the 2014 fires directly. And it was pure resiliency of the people here getting out, trying to get out. We had five of our fire engines burned over, melted the bars. That started, so the fire started on Monday, July 14th, and we had, that day we had over 250 lightning strikes, and in a 24-hour period of time. So we had put out a lot of fires as a fire department, as a district fire department, long before we had the last four that didn't get put out there. Those four fires ended up joining together. And in actually, on Monday, we've gone out to multiple fires. On Tuesday, my particular engine was sent out at 5 p.m. I never stopped till Saturday morning, 6 a.m. So to give you an idea of what that looks like, I'm going to have some video here But let's see, let me make sure I'm hitting everything. What the difference was here was we had red flag warnings, and most of you probably know what those are. High drought conditions, low humidity. It was over 100 degrees that day, and it was 50 to 70 mile winds. So this is on Thursday that I'm talking about. On Thursday is when everything blew up, and there was a 126,000 acre run in that day. I've never seen anything like it. I've watched California on the news with Santa Ana winds, and I can only liken it to some of what they've dealt with. Also, the thing that makes it different is obviously the extent of damage that was done. It was we lost 316 homes in the Carlton Complex. In terms of the terrorist impacts, as city mayor, obviously I know all those in very specific detail. We lost 10% of all of our households in the city limit. Can you imagine losing 10% of Seattle, of your homes in Seattle, or 10% in Wenatchee? What it does is it takes out a huge population of the people that help you. Your postmaster, maybe it's your teachers, maybe it's your person who delivers the newspaper. And in a small community in rural Washington, usually there's only one person that does that job or does something. And if they've been impacted, it impacts everybody. Okay? So 2 to 4 students in each grade, K through 12, lost their homes, and 1/5 of the staff. And there was $2.6 million of damage to the school. And it was 156 homes in the Padera School District. All right, go ahead. So we're going to go, this video is 6 minutes long, and I'm going to show you what it looked like, what it felt like. A lot of people can't relate to that. All of our volunteers that come and help get to see this video so they understand what it looked like. The pictures that you'll see here are daytime.
Okanagan 911, what is the address of your emergency?
Hello, I live in French Creek, and I'm seeing to the west of me a really large plume of smoke. I'm wondering if that's been called in already.
Okanagan County 911, what's the address of your emergency?
I live down here in Carlton, just a mile south of Carlton, and I got smoke coming up on the other side of the ridge southeast of me.
A call from 260 C. Charles, Texas Creek, advising the flames are coming over the hill approximately half a mile from their residence.
Okanagan 911, what is the address of your emergency?
2031, Highway 153. Fires back up again. It's all in our stuff. Get ready to put us out.
Okay, how close to the residence is it?
We're at the residence. It's there.
Okay, is it, how close to the residence is it? Is it right up to the residence?
Yes.
Okay, I will let the fire crew know.
We're evacuating, so are the neighbors. There may be close to 100 homes on the chill list in danger at this moment.
Okay.
We're the last house on the road.
Yeah, Jerry.
Please send some help. Fire.
Jerry. Hello?
Huh?
Take a deep breath. I need Jerry. Where is the fire from where you're at?
There is straight west of us on the hill above Cholas Creek and parallel to the creek. Above the beaver ponds, the big meadow.
Above the beaver pond.
The fire is parallel to the creek and above the beaver
pond. How far is that from your house?
Huh?
How far is that from your house?
How far from the house? I would say quarter mile.
Quarter mile?
Yeah, maybe half at the most. And,
okay.
And it's moving quickly this way. We spotted it break over the top.
When the stars go out, address of your emergency?
We are right downtown Pateras. We have ashes that have fallen over on the commercial drive. They're spreading down. There's nobody over here.
Commercial drive, what's on fire there?
The brush along the railroad tracks.
Brush at the railroad tracks. Okay, hang on just a moment, okay? Commercial Street in Pateras. Brush igniting near the railroad tracks. 1942. Okay, what is your name, ma'am?
My name's Libby Harrison. I'm the mayor of Pateras here.
Libby Harrison?
Yes.
Okay, what's up on up to you, Libby?
Oh my gosh, there's another fire on the highway. They're popping up everywhere. We need somebody down here quick.
They're getting as much as they can.
I know. Oh my god, okay.
Where's the other fire, Libby?
There's a fire. There's a fire in Yancey's, storage.
Okay, I'm not responding, and received a call from 93 Curly Horse Drive. Advised her parents are hiding in the shower at that location for immediate.
24 Okanagan, I don't know if we can make it through. I was up there a little ways. Myself and six will be en route to attempt.
24, they said it's the large white residence you see.
We can't see anything down here past the front of our cars. When the lights go
out. Okanagan 911, what is the address of your emergency?
I'm in Pitcairn, Washington at the Lakeshore Inn. I have people stuck in the elevator and the fire's upon us. I need one of the emergency people to come pry it open for me.
Okay, they're stuck in the elevator?
Yes.
At the Lakeshore Inn.
And they've evacuated the chairs and we can't get it open.
And they've what?
The fire's right within me.
I'm sorry, I can't, you're yelling into the phone, I can't understand.
I'm sorry, it's really loud here. The fire is right next to us. We've evacuated the town, and I'm the owner of the hotel. The homes we built are burning down to the ground, to the
The sheriff says we gotta get out. I can't believe it's real. Man on his rooftop praying songs. Our men on the mountain all night long. With nerves of steel. Take the picture. I'll hear. the wind chimes sing all
So that helps. How many of you thought it looked like that? Any of you? A few of you? Okay. What you need to understand is that when Kirsten seriously talks about resources and people being, we had seven county sheriffs on duty that day. Seven. Okay? There's no way that people can be evacuated completely and that everybody can respond. And that's why we are pushing that message out so strong about taking care of yourself to some degree. Because when you are in a huge disaster, the resources are not there. I was the incident command, I was the resource manager for the incident command team out of our fire department. I couldn't get hold of emergency management. I never once talked to him on the phone or could contact him. They pulled people from all up around the state in to help at that time. But you have to understand that's what it looks like. And that everyone has to rise and show some leadership in that. So what happened was, as Julie Milliard explained, and she is our president of our Okanagan County Long-Term Recovery Group. I had to beg her to do that, by the way. And I'm trying to prevent her from resigning in December. So you can help me. If you see her, tell her she's doing a great job. She needs to stay on. So what happened was we got different groups formed together. Different leaders came together. Met one in the Medjool Valley, one in the Bateras-Brewster area, and one in the Chilliwack and Lot areas. what we were shooting for was inclusive representation so that everybody around the county could be represented and could contribute to recovery. So I recommended that we do it just like we did with our fire. We had three incident command teams, actually we had four, but in different locations, taking care of different parts of the fire. So we set it up just the same way and did a countywide countywide organization with three representatives from each. Okay. So then, obviously in 2015, we were in place and we were doing recovery work at that time. We had disaster case management in place, other pieces in place. And so we went ahead and said yes to taking on the 2015 fires and situation. We added four counties. We added Chelan, Douglas, Ferry, and Stevens counties because they all had burns and losses. And so this is what we ended up, this is what we do and have done for the last several years, is we do volunteer coordinating. It's really cutting out, isn't it?
Yeah, you're okay.
Okay, doing volunteer coordination. We've done a lot of advocacy and policy recommendations and changes. I really like that Hillary Franz is all about listening to people. I've received invitations for the last 3 years on giving input. I've been back to DC twice, been to Olympia I don't know how many times, and we've seen huge changes. And there were huge changes between the 2014 and the 2015 fires in the way that they were attacked and the way they were dealt with. And the silos were dropping like crazy. Agencies started really working together 100 times better than they were prior to that. We have an unmet needs roundtable. They have met every Friday at 9:30 since the fire. They're still meet every week. And we distribute funds that were donated during the fire. We are almost done with that. So we've had major partners. We've worked with about partnerships of about $3 to $5 million, depending on how you look at it. Whether you credit the in-kind donations and so on, but somewhere around $5 million. Disaster case management is the center of all recovery. If you don't have disaster case managers, you have no idea what people need and how they're going to get that and what their plan is to recover. So they're integral. Some of the other projects we'll talk about, but we also are doing our rebuild program. We're in phase three of that. But the keys to effective recovery are community-driven and grassroots, inclusive and diversified. It's really easy for us to sit around a table with like minds. That's what we tend to do. Recovery requires people that are not like you at the table. Otherwise, you won't get complete holistic recovery. And so then it represents every area of the community. And you need to think outside the box. You can come up with unique ways to recovery or do any activity. Be realistic. There's a lot of people that say, oh, we're going to do this, we're going to build that, we're going to do this. You have to be realistic with what you can do. On that same note, don't accept no. If someone tells you, the biggest thing I kept hearing, that's an ambitious project. How many have heard that? That is an ambitious project. They're basically saying you're never going to get it done, right? Okay, so we didn't like that. We didn't listen to that. You must under-promise and over-deliver. There is nothing worse to promising things to people that are hurt and survivors that don't, where you don't deliver. Okay, and long-term is, we just got some new cases last month. Don't think that people all recover at the same rate. We had some people that still have not pulled out their foundations. They have not progressed. I just like those pictures that I showed you earlier, the house is completely burned, still in the same position. They can't handle it yet. Okay? Go ahead, Jen. So these are some of the things that we've done, miles and miles of fence. How much does fence building over here in Rock Country cost? About 10 grand a mile. 10 grand a mile. The DNR programs in the 70s that did all that fencing, we had a lot of properties that had half DNR fence and half personal fence. For orchards, what happens? They can't replace it. So we did miles and miles and miles of fence building with volunteers. A lot of foliage, burn foliage work. We've had six NCCC AmeriCorps teams come in and work here. AmeriCorps is awesome. If you do not support AmeriCorps in disaster, I can tell you, they have made such a difference here and in Texas. We couldn't have done it without them. Tree removal, we had several Sawyer teams actually come up from Arizona. I'm really actually trained, the Methodist trained Sawyer teams here to be able to come back in. We just had one of those come last week again. It's a long process. We've done bridge repair, we've done road work, and then of course pets and animals have been kind of a big deal. And outbuildings and so on. Cleanup, usually there's just ash and trash, metal, or the materials that you burn or bury, and then the foundation removal. And the removal of vehicles with burned titles was kind of an issue. Yeah, how do you prove that that's your car that's all burned up metal right there? And for replacement or for anything, what a hassle. Big logistics. Let's see, advocacy, mental support. We had more people die after the fire because of emotional situations than we ever did in the fire. Okay, we are still dealing with that. We've had suicide attempts. I had a neighbor that literally had a heart attack on an excavator trying to get his home rebuilt, trying to get his land done. There's been a lot of different stories through that. So it's been really hard on the community. The other piece is that it takes time. In a disaster like this, they anticipate 10 years to fully recover. And we're at 3.5, almost 4. We'll be at 4 in July. Okay? So I only know of half a dozen homes that were partially burned. This is pretty much what everything looked like at the end, after the fire went through. Pretty much every home. Okay? And of course, it took several weeks or even months where people wanted to sift through everything to find a ring. We found wedding rings, we found different pieces, mostly ceramics made it. Specialty pieces that maybe some china from a great grandmother or those kind of pieces. But people tried to do that. Some did, some didn't. You saw the different reactions. Okay? So this is just an example again of some of the work that was done. That's sifting up on top. And obviously we have piles of metal. And then that foundation work was pretty tough. We did a special thing in Pateras. We opened up our industrial area to to collect all of the concrete in our school district. We crushed it up as part of a FEMA project, and we built sidewalks in Pateras out of it and put plaques in it. Okay? We still have people living in those kind of structures right now. We're on our last phase of rebuild, so it's been tough, but a lot of people lived in these. Go ahead.
I think the best part of this job is working with the clients directly and getting to go out to their sites, to their homes, or where their home stood, and just getting their story and listening to how they escaped the fire or how they built their house originally, why they're here, why they moved to the valley, why, you know, they grew up in the valley, and just getting their stories. And that's the fun part of the job, is just like figuring out these people's stories and then just really helping them with their recovery in such a personalized way, custom way. You know what I mean? They're all just so different from one client to another.
I'm camera shy. Yeah, this lady's making me nervous right now.
We came over this hill, about a 50 mile an hour winds pushing it over the hill. It was moving fast. Grabbed my dog, jumped in my car, and got the heck out of here.
Well, I started making payments on this property in 92. And anyway, a couple of my brothers decided to help me build a little house up there. Kept kind of the cabin. Nothing as fancy as this one, but it was good enough.
Just getting to know all these people in this community and my neighbors, and then, you know, the best part is a day like today where we had a dedication for a client who's been out of a house for 2.5 years and living in her van, living at her friend's house on the couch, to having a home where she has a wood stove. Everyone's got different lifestyles up here, and you know, it might be hard for some people to understand, but that's how they lived before, and they got along just well, you know, with their outhouse and their solar off-grid homes, or a small little house that was just, you know, a one-bedroom place. As we have people coming in to our community and educating and just, you know, describing that to people and having judgment and how people live the way they live.
So volunteers are a huge part of what we've done, and you can see on your sheets, if you look there, our volunteers from 2015 to 2017, go ahead, We have 1,770 volunteers just between those 2 years. That didn't include our relief in 2014. We had hundreds and hundreds of people come in and help immediately. 97 teams, 123,031 hours, and that completed 240 client projects or survivor projects that they requested. This is where our home rebuilt have been. We have three phases. We've completed 28 homes for vulnerable clients. And we have four homes in process right now. We were supposed to start foundations right before the flood or right before the flooding. And all of the heavy equipment is being utilized for flooding right now. So we haven't started those foundations, but we have about one full year from the time we started those foundations for the last five homes. Okay. This is what some of those homes look like. There's a team over in Mill Creek, North Creek Presbyterian Church, a bunch of retired engineers in their 70s and 80s that designed several of these panel homes, or actually took our architecture drawings of homes. They went over and learned how to make it in a week over on the coast. Then they brought that over here and they put it up. The fastest they put up the walls was 1 hour and 5 minutes. They were so proud of it. They were a little out of skew. We didn't ask them to ever hurry that fast again, but they were so proud of that. But we actually have a progression from day one to day five, what the house looks like when they brought that over. But they've done that for most of them. We'll see if they'll be able to do it for the next five homes. They've done one already. Okay? Okay. This is just this is actually our first homeowner family that received a home.
Hello, everybody. My name is Hugo Perez, and she's my wife, Juana.
My name is Juana Ascension.
Yeah, we were living in Black Canyon here in Pateros, where we lost everything there. We have a mobile home and tent that we collected during more than 20 years. And now we have this new house, and this means a lot for us. I mean, means everything. And I want to say thank you for those volunteers that really helped us. Thank you.
Sí,
thank you very much.
Diles. Oh, muchas gracias por darnos su ayuda, porque nos sentíamos perdidos, sin fuerzas, y con toda su ayuda. Tenemos muchas esperanzas ahorita de volver a empezar. También yo, con toda su ayuda me motivé y volví a empezar a tener mi jardín, y esta casa para mí es muy importante de ofrecerle a mis hijos. Muchas gracias y que Dios les multiplique todo lo que nos han ayudado. Gracias.
So there are a lot of people involved. If you don't know anything about Washington voluntary organizations active in disaster, I would encourage you to look that up and see what they do. It is basically a group of people. It's a national organization that helps coordinate disasters, nationally declared disasters. And we've partnered with all of those folks and then others for resources as well. So now what? What we've really wanted to encourage people to do is to speak up and participate in any decision making, any policy options, advocacy for creating systems and programs that help individuals. One of the biggest questions that we got asked was, why weren't they insured? Okay? One of those homes that we rebuilt, we paid a year in advance of insurance and were canceled 3 months in by the insurance company. It is not that easy to keep insurance over here. It is an ongoing battle and war to be able to get that, to have that. And so that's part of our advocacy thesis that we've done for the last 3 years. And part of it too was we had lawyers involved who these debris flows that come after wildfires, they are part of the wildfire, part of the damages. And the insurance companies did not want to declare those as part of the damages. And so there was a group that came together and pushed, if it was directly related, to get those benefits for people and gave people a helping hand. People are down and tired. They have to go back through their insurance list again and again and again when they submit. And in the case of a nationally declared disaster, they have extended time. It's 18 months instead of 12. That still is barely enough time for people. Some didn't get through it all after they've gone through and through and through. By the time you get depreciated, they got next to nothing for insurance in some cases and had trouble rebuilding. Okay? So we did have some really good folks, insurance. One of the things that we're going to do over the next year and a half is to survey all of our survivors, all of our cases, and ask them who was good, who wasn't, how it worked. And we're going to try and publish that down the road so we can have actual data to help people make decisions. Okay? So again, you can be knowledgeable and understand. You need to understand what your insurance looks like, what recovery looks like, what your fire preparedness looks like, your firewise. We had a large orchardist who paid, he was paying $31,000 a year in insurance premium, okay, for his orchards. And if he had $150 rider for his well pumps, he would have not had to put out $158,000 in generators to keep his crop alive so that he could harvest it. Okay? So know what you're doing. I mean, everyone here looks at their personal finances, their situation much differently, I can tell you, since a fire. Okay, and prepare and mitigate. So a lot of our programs going into the next couple years are about just that, preparing and mitigating. Okay. So one of those, what I found is that there was no funding right after the relief stage, response and relief stage, for long-term recovery. And we spoke with the governor's office, we spoke with legislators, we tried to get funds allocated for disaster. It is so difficult because funds get swept. They get reallocated and so on. So one of the things that we've come up with at the grassroots level is we're going to put on an event next summer that will do funds toward preparedness and mitigation and resiliency, and 60% of it will go into an endowment. We're trying to build $1 million a year. It will be a 3-year event, $1 million each year. That'll yield $150,000 a year for any nationally declared disaster, for disaster case management and long-term recovery in the state of Washington. It's not Eastern Washington, it's just any nationally declared disaster in the state of Washington. So what that looks like, it is starts at the Canadian border, goes all the way down to Astoria. It's a series of 30 tours, events, with 25 miles. And there's going to be runners, bikers, and rowers and paddlers. So it's kind of an event, fundraiser kind of thing, so just be looking for it down the road. We will be doing a pre-trip this summer for the planning of it. The governor and other legislators and so on, other groups have all given letters of recommendation for it, and we're pretty excited about it. Okay, next. This is another project we're doing, is the fire-shaped landscape. And this is actually what we'd like your funds today to contribute toward. This is a, we've been working on it most of the year. These are fires from 2008 through 2015, the burned areas. And it's going to be a driving map for people coming into the area that are interested in where the fires were, what it looked like, and so on. We've done 120 points of interest on a website that you can go in and refer to and see what happened where. Okay? So this is the back side of that same map with points of interest of where you can go to see some of the history of what happened through this process. And then also it's to give people on the coast, particularly, some fire prevention tips. I don't know how many of you come in and with catalytic converters and park in the dry grass off somewhere, thinking, man, there's tons of parking space over here, right? And then you drive away and we've got ourselves a little fire. Okay? That, one of the other common starts is chains between your trailer, your recreation trailers, and your trucks. Dragging and sparking fires there. Things like that. So anyway, this is designed to be a program that'll help share statewide some of the things you can do to prevent wildfire, and eventually we'd like to have along the DOT routes some signage and things about those fires. And then here on the end is fires at a glance, some of our biggest impacting fires, and the statistics having to do with those. Okay? Okay, questions?